Game On is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Well, you're still watching Game On live on Urban TV. We are streaming live as well on Facebook and on Twitter. Quickly, let's head into Ouagadougou Match Day 1. Africa Cup of Nations 2021 qualifiers will be getting underway tonight across Africa. And one of the places will be Ouagadougou, where the Uganda Cranes of Jonathan McKinstry will be trying to avenge that 2016 slim defeat away to Burkina Faso, the toughest cookie in Group B. Tough times for the Uganda Cranes. Why I say tough times? Because they are not as good as they look like when they're playing at home. But when they go on the road, you tend to worry for them. It's just another big, big, big night for the Irishman. It's the first game in charge in a competitive game. And you'd like to think he's ball for choice in a few areas. Of course, the question mark will be who will pair with Mourouchou Diouko at the back. But the good news is he's got plenty to pick up from in regards to tonight's game against Burkina Faso.
A very good squad, first of all. I think for me, like of course, as I mentioned on the show, majority of those players were pretty much the core side from the AFCON earlier this year down in Cairo. And one of the things that I've always talked about is that you've got competition in all the places because you've got at least two options for every single place in that particular team. And I think for me, the most important key pillars are going to be players like Dennis Onyango in goal, obviously Mourouchou Diouko, depending on who partners him. But chances are very high that that might be Hassan Wasswa ahead of Timothy Awani. Left back, we need to see Jajawa retiring a couple of weeks ago. So that means that the place is wide open. And I think for me, it's between Joseph Ocha and Isaac Muleme. You'd fancy probably Isaac Muleme to get in there because he offers you more defensively than Ochaya could actually give you. And then at right back, Nicolas Wadada seems to be the first choice ever since Dennis Iguma pretty much stepped out of the picture. You move to the midfield, there's a couple of options. You could speak of Tadeo Luanga, there's Khalid Aucho in there, and Mike Azira as well is in that particular team. So for me, all these players will be battling it out for the two holding goals in the particular team. And behind the striker, I expect probably Farouk Mia to slot in there. Up front, Emmanuel Okwi or probably Patrick Kadu should be leading the line. If Patrick Kadu leads the line, then Okwi should be playing down the right and then down the left side, and that would be a big conversation. We've seen players like Abdul Mala struggling for fitness. William Roger Kizito is in the squad, so it's going to be quite the challenge. But for Jonathan McKinstry, the focus will be on picking up a big start in this particular game and set the bar for the rest of the qualifiers.
The formation you just spelled out, Brian, it looks more offensive. It reminds me of the Desebre offensive-like football. What sort of formation do you think the Irishman will be going for? Because he's got to be cautious not to be exposed at the back. At the same time, he wants to have a good start to impress the Ugandans.
I think, first of all, he'll go with the back four. That is quite obvious. Chances are high he'll go with two holding midfielders. Obviously, one sitting quite deep to protect the back four, and then you've got one playing the box-to-box, which is the number eight. And two flanksmen who will bring a lot of pace to the particular team, and then one target man up front. So for me, it looks more or less a 4-2-3-1 going forward. And it's quite adjustable depending on what the situation of the game is. And that will be quite the pillar for the team. But again, just like I've already said, he'll also need to cut out the threat that Burkina Faso bring because they've got a lot of experience in players like Adama Traore. He might be young, but he's played at the very top level of the game at Chelsea. He's currently in France. I could speak of players like, you know, Petroipa, who scored the last time he went down to Burkina Faso. That was in 2016 as he lost by a goal to nil. I could speak of players like Banse. He's been part of this team for nearly a decade. So I think for me, Burkina Faso have got a lot of competition they bring. And you should also remember that until this year, they had been the regulars at the tournament and they were always very competitive every time they would go down to the AFCON. So it's arguably the toughest game we've got in these particular qualifiers, and it's upon the boys to show the character, show the experience as well, because we know it's gone are the days when the Cranes would struggle on the road. Of late, we've pretty much picked up that solid performance and confidence going away.
While you talk about the big boys with Burkina Faso, Nolu Mala, Ronald Muchibe, I didn't expect him, even if he was fit, to start at the back with Mourouchou Diouko. But we like to think that with Lumala's pace, the kind of pace he showcased during the AFCON 2019, will be heavily missed tonight.
I think if you remember, after putting in quite the shift at the tournament, we did get to see Sebastian Sabri taking him along with him when he was moving into pyramids in Egypt. So The kind of pace he brings, because what he does is that he may not score the goals for you, but he pulls the defenders out of position and he opens up spaces for all the other forwards. And I think for me that is something that the team actually needs. And then on top of that, when he plays off the shoulders of most of the defenders, he forces them to make so many different errors, and that plays into the hands of the Uganda Cranes, especially if you've got guys like Farouk Mia who can play within the spaces, who can make the most of the set pieces where they get come through as well. And the Cranes were a bit tactical at the AFCON as well, because if you notice, we made the most of the corners, we made the most of the free kicks as well. You could clearly see that we had become the dead ball specialists with this particular team. So for me, it's going to be quite the miss if he doesn't make the final cut. And you have a sense that there's also a lot of quality in the team. And that would be a big boost for William Lwakizito to step up and fill those boots that are left by Lumala.
Well, Coach Malo Kamau coming out to talk to my boys and tell them about what the story that Uganda Cranes had in 2017 going into 2019. That story might just be the same story going into the AFCON 2021. If Burkina Faso, rather, if the Uganda Cranes upset Burkina Faso in Ouagadougou and get the vengeance from 2016. The big boys in there, just like Brian just mentioned, Bertrand Traoré replacing Leon, Charles Kabore in there, Petroiba, Jonathan Aristide, that is Banse, we talk about Brian Dabo, among others, set to pose as a threat to the Uganda Cranes backline going into match day one. Match day two will be this very Sunday against Malawi. Elsewhere tonight across Africa in the forthcoming AFCON 21 qualifiers, we do have Malawi set to welcome Southern Sudan in the other Group B affair, while Central Africa Republic gets to welcome Burundi, Cape Verde away to Cameroon, Guinea-Bissau welcoming Eswatini. As for Chad, they get to visit Namibia, Nigeria, Benin, Lesotho, Sierra Leone, and Angola, Gambia, Congo away to Senegal, and finally Sudan facing Sao Tome and Principe. That should be a win for Sudan, given that Sao Tome and Principe are below the bar. Away from that, let's now head back here in the Uganda Premier League. Former league champions and Vipers Sports Club did remain unbeaten following last evening's slim victory against the tax collectors, Muzei Daniel Serunkuma, with the goal that did matter on the day. 3 points in the back, 6 points clear. That is in Vipers at the top of the pile. Interesting times for our Vipers. Again, for me, it's about consistency. It's about winning each game as it comes. And for URA, it's damage control in a way, because just when you thought they'd picked up after seeing out, that should have been Police FC, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Then you have Vipers right in front of you. And then just the one goal making the difference. I watched Ojera falling out, or rather having a bit of an outburst with Sam Simbwa, something that we didn't ignore, because if Sam Simbwa is now showing emotions on the field of play, on the touchline, imagine what is happening behind the scenes when they don't get things right.
I think Sam Simba is starting to feel the pressure. He's feeling the heat as well, you know, in some circles, because he knows the kind of performance that URA had last season set the bar quite high for the boys. And at the end of the day, it was always going to be quite the big task ahead of them to pretty much come through and put up those kinds of performances. And I think for me, some of the key players have not entirely been able to show up. Obviously, they've lacked that threat up front as well. They've lacked a go-to man who can score you about 10 to 15 goals every single season. And again, it comes back to players like Ashraf Manera who are brought in. We could probably speak of players like, you know, Daniel Isiagi in that particular team. Most of us have not entirely been the spark that they've been hoping for. For me, I like what players like Shafiq Kajimu bring to this URA team. You could speak of players like Saidi Cheyune, because they've stuck in there. They've kept fighting for the team. But quite the incident there. Kimoja recently came on for the national team.
You can't afford to do that. That's unforgivable. And surprisingly, it wasn't even sent off. That should have been a red card. I mean, slapping someone in the face like that, the modern day game, you're bound to get a red card. Look at how Simba reacted. Come back here, dragging his shot down to the touchline. You can't plead against that. That, for me, is a red card all day long. But talk about how they consider that goal. Serunkuma in open space for a man of his quality, you can't afford to give him space like that, because he will punish you eventually.
He will, because for those that know Serunkuma, he's the target man, he's the go-to guy. He knows what the frame of goal is when you give him the opportunity, and he's never going to think twice about putting that ball into the back of the net. And he also knew that in the absence of Fahad Bayo, he was the guy that was supposed to lead the line for the team. I saw Tito Okello as well thrown into the fray. Marahima Tsevuka was pulling all the strings in the midfield. Alan Kayo as well was in the fray. But I've got to commend URA because for the better part of the game, they pretty much absorbed all the pressure that was being thrown that way by Vipers. And James Salith was well, proving to be quite solid in the frame of goal. But ultimately, for Vipers, they look like a team that knows how to get the result, even when you'd think it's not the best of days in office. And that keeps them unbeaten. They are firm at the top of the standings. And I think for me, if they can keep up what they've started, they are going to be such a ruthless team for the rest of the season.
Down in Jinja, more drama unfolded. Douglas Bamoyan and company, they were not too happy with the decision made by the referee handing Busoga United a penalty late on, denying Maroons all 3 points, having opened the scoring. Again, for me, it goes down to discipline, regardless of what happens on the field, because it will come down haunting you with the way Bamwena reacted, wanting, you know, to fight the officials, a couple of other bad sceneries in Busoga down in Jinja. It's not the kind of outing you want to see, but a 1-0 draw and very satisfying for Busoga. But again, the fans ranting about the poor performance of Busoga, who avoided their fourth defeat. Bogere out of the job. Does he remain? Does he go? Or does he take the team forward? But for Bamwene's attitude, not what I thought in terms of the kind of way he displays himself, the slick suits and all that. But a point on the day for both sides.
A point for both sides. I think it was a very tight game. We had spoken about that yesterday, because going into this game, these two teams were separated by a point. And you could clearly see that they were always going to battle for this game, you know, head-to-head. And just when you felt like probably Maroons were going to take all the 3 points away from home, there was that late penalty that was converted by Bogere to make sure that he kept the scoreline quite respectable. And for me, if you look at this Maroons team, they've played like a unit. They've had some players that have been quite outstanding. I like what the, you know, Bamoyana is doing with Steven Mukwala. He's turning out to be quite the key player for them ever since they got him from Vipers. And clearly, there had been a conversation about the quality of the pitch as well, because if you look at it there, the rains have pretty much messed it up. And that also affects the quality of the game of football that we get to see. But for Busoga, they were without Joel Madondo, who is arguably their target man. I think he lost a family relative, you know, over the course of last week. So he was allowed that time off. But ultimately, it's a point that Busoga will feel like probably they'll come very far from to pick up. And ultimately, it keeps them in the conversation for the top places, because if I'm not mistaken, they're somewhere around seventh. And by the look of things, they are quite the team that is playing some exciting football.
Solomon Okalinga is breast-inspiring. The Ankole Lions to 3 points against Onduparaka. We didn't see the result coming, given the fact that Imbara City were struggling or were struggling for form. But surprisingly for Onduparaka, they lost just like they did against the Ankole Lions last season under the watch of Branson Nyondo. But a let finish right there from Okalinga, who yet again came out to deliver for Imbara City.
For Imbara City, they were quite lucky to come out with the result, because twice they were behind, twice they came from back to win the game. And interestingly, actually they led the game. They allowed Onuparaka to come back and score the equalizer before they could actually score the winner. And you can see the thing about Imbara City right now is that they are looking for stability, because after you part ways with a coach like, you know, Livingston Babazi, and then you've got a guy like Paul Nkata coming through, and now you've got guys like Brian Senyondo coming back and getting the job done, they are looking for that final kicker in terms of picking up results. And I think for me, for them as a team, they know that it's going to be very important that they keep picking up points, because they need to climb up in terms of the table standings, and then they also need to make sure that they keep their safety as well. But for Onduparaka, they arrived for this game on Monday, and they had traveled from Arua through a distance of about 700 kilometers. So probably the fatigue as well came back to haunt them. And most of the players looked quite rugged. They lacked that cutting edge, even when you felt like after they had beaten Chetume by 7-1 in their last outing, they didn't entirely replicate that kind of form, especially in front of goal. So it left a lot to be desired for Onduparaka. They were without Livingston Babazi in this particular game. They didn't really carry that much threat, especially going forward, because for players like Maringomo, for players like Malish in there, they didn't look like the players we had seen against Chetume. And for me, if they are going to stay in the top four, they need to stop the tendency of blowing hot and cold. They need a consistent run of results that will keep them in the running for the top places, or even put themselves in the conversation for the league.
Well, the Purple Sharks made it 2 on a bounce with a 3-0 victory away to Chetume FC, who came out to register their fourth defeat in their last 5 games. And I tell you what, it gets better, because the Mwakiso Giants, having fired Kefa Kisala, it looks like Stephen Bengo is doing a good job and might just, well, get this one here on a permanent basis. And as for Pro Line, despite getting all 3 points on match day 13, they remained rock bottom. 2-1 winners over Bright Stars, Idrissa Lubega, and a 1 Chuanuka Hakim getting the goals for Pro Line FC. Their first maximum points since their 6 points were docked in regards to the UPL. Forget about the UPL. It will continue later on today with 3 fine fixtures. But I tell you what, that and much more to follow after this break.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game on is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.